Did you know over 50% of misused prescriptions come from family and friends? That's why we all have a role to play in prescription safety, both as parents and as patients. Know your script. Keep medications safely stored and out of reach, and properly dispose of unused medications. To learn more, visit knowyourscript.org. This important message brought to you by the Bear River Health Department and USU Extension.
Spring, hopefully, is just around the corner, which means it's time to dust off your running shoes, tighten your laces, and run down to the Sports Academy to add a little spring to your health and fitness. The Sports Academy can help you spring into shape with the largest selection of group fitness classes, certified trainers, a new registered dietitian, or check out our brand new Stop Pilates studio. Feel great, love life, and add a little spring to your step at the Sports Academy. Your club, your results, your life.
This copyrighted broadcast is an exclusive presentation of Learfield under the broadcasting rights granted by Utah State University. Reuse of this presentation is prohibited without the expressed written consent of the university and Learfield. Announcers are provided by Learfield and approved by the university.
Welcome to the KSL Sports Zone studio. I'm Corey Anderson with your halftime scoreboard update. Utah State currently leading San Diego State 29-28 at the half of the Mountain West Tournament Championship game. One other local game of interest tonight, Southern Utah will take on Grand Canyon in the WAC Tournament Championship game. Winner gets the automatic bid to the NCAA tournament. That one tips at 9:30 tonight. The Big 12 Championship game is underway in Kansas City right now. Number 7 Texas with a 39-33 lead over number 3 Kansas in the Big 12 title game. The Big East championship game underway as well, and right now it is all Marquette.
...7% from the floor, 15 of 32. KU 13 of 31 at 42%. The
He did get it. Nice little quick defensive weapon after the throw down by Wagner. As the ball gets thrown inside and then thrown away off of Carter, it's heat ball. Missed opportunity by Orlando, up 9-4 after Wagner crammed one in. Wasn't clean, but he got it over and let Tyler know all about it. So 9-4, Orlando up front, 9:31 here in the first. Gabe working on the right side, gets it to Love. Love's first touch, he gets it right back to Gabe. Powers, right hand layup, and it's good. Vincent 2-for-2 to start the game. 9-6, he trailed by 3. 9-15 here in the first quarter. 3-ball, long by Carter. Rebound by Tyler. The kick ahead to Love. Love, the one you're with. He gets fouled. Who's trying to hate on Love down there? That's Carter, his first personal foul.
His first team foul.
Orlando 9, Miami 6. Love will go to the line for the first time in the contest. Matter of fact, first free throws of the game. When the Heat win, you win with Papa John's Pizza. If your Heat beat the Magic tonight, and let me tell you something, I need this personally. I'm hosting a party tomorrow. If I get this 50% off my entire regular menu priced order online or at papajohns.com or on the app, I'm going to just fire in the promo code HEATWIN and get half off that order. It's going to be a big one, too. Papa John's is your official delivered pizza of your Miami Heat. I haven't used the promo code in a year and a half, so I don't know if I'm asking for a lot, but I'm asking for it.
Suns postgame show. Brought to you by Budweiser Zero.
And here comes Booker into the forecourt, dribbling on the left wing. He'll step into a three, and it goes around the rim, off the backboard, and drops through. Booker gets the roll from downtown. Suns within one. Give Book 28 on the night.
And that's where Devin Booker finished tonight. He had 28 points, and the Suns lost tonight, 128-119. The Sacramento Kings come into Phoenix tonight and get a pretty big win in that Western Conference race. The Kings now at 40-26. First time the Kings have won 40 games in a season since the 05-06 season. The Grizzlies also get a win tonight over the Mavericks. I'll have the complete NBA scoreboard coming up later on in the show. The Mavericks played in Memphis tonight without Luka Doncic and without Kyrie Irving, who was a late scratch because of a foot injury. So the Kings and Grizzlies a hold serve tonight. They both get a W, so they are now both 40-26 on the season. Suns fall to 37-30. The Suns are now 9 back of the Nuggets and 3.5 back of both the Kings and the Grizzlies with 15 to play. Durant out for 3 weeks, and the Warriors and Bucks up next. So I think for the Suns, I don't know how you feel about it as a Suns fan. Do you start recalibrating expectations and goals? And instead of pointing towards that 2 seed, do you say to yourself, let's just try to hang on to a top 4 seed? Currently, the Clippers in 5th right now, 2 games back of the Suns at 36-33. That's where the Clippers are at. So however you want to look at it, whether you not, you still believe the Suns can make a run at both the Kings and the Grizzlies for a top 2, maybe a 3 seed, or are you content with them holding off the Clippers and the Warriors and everybody else to get a top 4 seed in the Western Conference playoffs. Obviously, with about 3.5 weeks to play in the regular season, a lot of time to talk about that. But again, without Kevin Durant now, the complexion of this race in terms of just how far the Suns can ascend, it changes. It doesn't mean the Suns can't do it. It doesn't mean they can't go on a run, and it doesn't mean they can't win in Golden State on Monday and beat the Bucks at home on Tuesday. But let's be honest, things are a lot more difficult now with Kevin Durant on the sidelines for at least 3 weeks. So the Kings come in here tonight, get a win, 128-119. The final again, Chris Paul, 16 points, 16 assists. DeAndre Ayton had 22-12. But again, the story tonight, the Kings bench, 65 points, 11 threes. Killer second half three-pointers from Davion Mitchell, Malik Monk, and Kessler Edwards throughout that fourth quarter to keep the Suns at bay. All right, out to the phone lines for the first time tonight. Thomas is in Glendale, but it's Glendale, California, calling from beyond state lines. Thomas, what's on your mind? Welcome to the show.
I wanted to talk about Darius Baisley. When Chris Paul was in Oklahoma City, the year that he spent there, Darius Baisley was a rookie. And I followed Oklahoma City's games during a period of time. And the guy is a 40% three-point shooter, and he's an excellent rebounder. I don't understand why James Jones traded for this guy. And to me, he has more talent than the guys that's coming off the bench. But I don't think he has been looked at in that regard.
Well, all right, Thomas, let me jump in. Thomas, thanks. Good call. I can appreciate the inquiry on Darius Baisley. Fair enough. I don't think it really matters for tonight's game. I don't think Baisley would have made a difference. But I think you're talking about still a young player who has not been a part of this rotation for a while. You can only go so deep on your bench. Now, Baisley did play against the Thunder, had 3 points, played 10 minutes. A lot of that was a mop-up time as the Suns won that game by 31 points. But I think when you talk about the acquisition of Baisley, I think that's more long-term. I think the Suns right now are in a Western Conference race in a battle for playoff positioning. I think they go pretty deep as it is, and it's not about Baisley's skill set. It's about if Monty Williams felt Darius Baisley gave them a better chance to win a basketball game, he would be out there. And I think right now at this point, considering he's only been here for a couple of weeks, where he's at and his development as a player, while the skill set is there and the opportunity for him to make plays,
and do good things on the court is certainly there. I think in the given situation for the Phoenix Suns right now, Monty just feels that there are other guys, whether it be Biombo or Terrence Ross or Jock Landale, Torrey Craig, when he's coming off the bench, that these are the guys right now that he feels gives them the best chance to win. But I think Baisley's a guy the Suns look at as a guy who's certainly capable of impacting this roster and this basketball team in the future. But for tonight, Baisley did not get off the bench for the Suns. Again, he played a little bit against the Thunder, played a little bit against the Bulls, and you know that's pretty much been it. And right now, they just don't think that he's going to be a factor in the rotation. And I think if he's not playing now, he's certainly not going to be a factor in the playoff rotation when the postseason rolls around. Speaking of Monty Williams, we're going to hear from the Suns head coach coming up after the timeout. Once again, 128-119 Suns fall to the Sacramento Kings tonight at Footprint Center. The Suns now 22-11 at home. They had come in 16-5 in their last 21 games. So recently, when you talk about how well the Suns have been playing, a rare loss tonight on the home court. Kings get them 128-119. Monty Williams coming up after the break.
Suns Post Game Show with John Bloom, brought to you by Budweiser Zero.
Zero, the crisp, refreshing taste you can expect from a beer without alcohol. Be 100% on your game with the new Budweiser Zero, official partner of the Phoenix Suns and sponsors of the Suns postgame show on Arizona Sports, the local sports leader. Enjoy every game this season responsibly. If you drink, don't drive. Decide to ride.
Progressive presents Adjusting to the Suburbs. You used to associate crickets with silence. But since you bought a house in the suburbs, you know crickets hate silence. If any other creature realized rubbing its legs together made a piercing, high-pitched noise, they might think, maybe I won't do that. Constantly. All night long. Luckily, you can save with Progressive by bundling your home and auto. Now that's something to make noise about. Just not constantly. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company coverage provided in service by affiliates and third-party insurers.
What's for dinner? Burgers?
After last week? No thanks.
Avoiding foods due to fear of diarrhea, gas, bloating, stomach pain, or loose oily stools? It may not be just stomach issues. It could be EPI, or exocrine pancreatic insufficiency. EPI can cause uncomfortable symptoms because it's a condition where the pancreas doesn't release enough digestive enzymes to break down food. But EPI can be managed. Use the symptom checker on identifyepi.com and talk to your doctor about your symptoms. That's identifyepi.com. Sponsored by AbbVie.
Hello there. My name is Seychelle, and what makes the Chick-fil-A chicken sandwich original to me is the punch of flavors that's unlike any other. You get the crispy tenderness of the chicken and that hint of sourness from the pickles. Ta-da!
Hey, I'm Juan, and what makes the Chick-fil-A chicken sandwich original to me is you know you're going to get chicken that's crispy, golden, and juicy. This is the gold standard of chicken sandwiches.
Order the original Chick-fil-A chicken sandwich on the Chick-fil-A app today. Real customers paid for their testimonials.
Toilet clogged? No hot water? No worry. Spending too much on bottled water? No worry. AC or heating breaks on the weekend? No worry. Can't find your credit card? No, that you may have to worry about. Gamble here for Collins Comfort Masters. Hey, Collins can't solve everything, but they can help with all your heating, plumbing, and water treatment needs. And that is why I use them. All their work is backed by their no-worry guarantee. You'll get top-quality craftsmanship done right the first time. They take that so seriously, they put it in their phone number, 480-NO-WORRY. We're talking industry-leading warranties like parts and compressor warranties of at least 10 years, some even 15, and others lifetime. Wow. Available 24/7, 365 days a year. They get out to you in minutes, not days. So for all your AC, heating, plumbing, and water treatment needs, call my friends at Collins Comfort at 480-NO-WORRY. All my listeners should be using Collins. Call 480-NO-WORRY or go to collinscomfort.com.
John Bloom, Suns Post Game Show, brought to you by Budweiser Zero.
Here's Booker dribbling near side, gets around the screen from Wainwright, top of the arc, pushes off with Mitchell, gets a pick from Ayton and swings to Paul. He wants a three right wing. Give it to him. CP3 from downtown. He got it from D-Book, his sixth assist of the night. Paul into double figures with 12 points to go with his 14 assists.
Yeah, Chris Paul had 16 tonight, 16 assists. Didn't shoot the ball great from beyond the arc, only 2 for 9.
from three-point range, and that coupled with Torrey Craig's 0 for 4 and Ish Wainwright's 1 for 6 did not help the cause on a night the Suns certainly needed more offense, because the defense, Monty Williams talked about it after the game. We're going to hear from Monty in a little bit. Just too many mistakes, too many my bads, Monty said, when it came to the Suns' defensive effort tonight as the Kings put up 128 in a win tonight. Remember, they are the highest scoring team in the NBA, averaging just over 121 points a game, and they hang 128 on the Suns tonight behind a massive performance by that Kings bench, scoring 65 points. Kings did lead the game by 8 at the half. Third quarter, though, midway through the third, the Suns go on a 16-3 run to take a 4-point lead on a Chris Paul 3, 85-81. But Malik Monk shot the lights out at the end of the third quarter to kind of keep the Kings in the game as Terrence Ross heated up. And the Kings led this game 96-95 after three. And in the fourth quarter, the Suns took the lead a couple of times. But down the stretch, again, the Kings made the plays, got the calls. The Suns did not make the plays, and they did not get the calls. Monty Williams, after the game, Suns fall 128-119.
They're a really good team. Offensively, they score with the best of them, but we had so many my bads and blown coverages tonight. It just stacked against us. And then you couple that with them having 36 free throws, and then they made some threes, one off the glass, the one at the end, like stuff like that. It was just too many holes to dig out of tonight. I didn't think we played with the sharpness and game plan discipline that it takes to, you know, play against a team that's hungry. That team hasn't been to the playoffs in a long time, and they're chasing something. And I didn't feel like we chased tonight. I thought we were not as sound as we need to be to play against a really good offensive team. We hung in there, but we just didn't have the level of game plan discipline that it takes to, you know, win a game like that. And we just kept fouling them. I mean, they had, you know, 37 free throws, I think. That's a lot of free throws. And it was a physical game. So it's like, what do? Am I supposed to get up here and say something crazy and then get a fine and then come back tomorrow and say, oh, I'm human? I don't need to do all that. It's pretty obvious that there were some calls that didn't go our way, and there were a number of calls that went their way.
And on the challenge, was it? I know you looked to the bench to see if you go
in. Just took so long to get it in. I didn't want to lose it, and I didn't want to take it home with me. And I had a timeout, so it didn't. It wasn't one of those where I was enthusiastically thinking I was going to win it. But I thought it was an opportunity to at least try. And so I didn't want to take it home with me.
That's Monty Williams talking about challenging that offensive foul on Devin Booker. The Suns at that time were down 121-118 after De'Aaron Fox jumper with 105 to play, put the Kings up by that 3-point margin. Suns had a chance to come down, cut it to one, or maybe tie it with a three. Booker gets called for the offensive foul on Sabonis. It looked like, you know, Monty, you have to challenge it because, as Monty says, you can't take it home. But that was going to be a tough one to overturn, even though it looked like Sabonis had his hand in there and he was kind of fouling Book even before Book's hand hit his face. The bigger challenge that I thought went by the board was off the jump ball. It looked like Sabonis hit that ball out of bounds. Monty chose to hang on to the challenge, or at least not challenge that particular play, and Sabonis immediately scored a layup there with just about 3:05 to play to give the Kings a 2-point lead, a lead they would never relinquish. 128-119, the final. Kings knock off the Suns tonight. The Suns' 4-game winning streak is history. Now they go on the road to take on the Warriors on Monday, and then back home to take on Giannis and the Bucks on Tuesday. So it does not get any easier for the Phoenix Suns right now playing without Kevin Durant. We'll take a break when we come back. Song of the night, Hustle winner tonight, and also your NBA scoreboard on a busy night in the NBA. Keep it here.
Suns Post Game Show with John Bloom, brought to you by Budweiser Zero.
you're on the treadmill, on the trail, at the job site, walking the dog, open up the Arizona Sports app and listen live. Read breaking sports news, get podcasts, check in with the local teams, and more. The Arizona Sports app is presented by Ready Sir.
Men, are you Roman ready for the weekend? Right now, generic Viagra, a.k.a. Sildenafil, is just $4 per dose at Roman. Just complete a free online visit with a U.S. licensed healthcare professional. If medication is appropriate, Roman sends what you need in discreet packaging with free two-day shipping. Generic Viagra from $4 at Roman. Go to ro.co/Viagra. Do it today and get 20% off your entire first order. That's ro.co/Viagra.
This is Sanderson Ford Country. Howdy, everybody. This rodeo announcer, Doug Mathis, for Sanderson Ford Cave Creek Pro Rodeo. We've changed it up a little bit this year to add an additional night of action-packed bull riding. That's right. All bulls all night on Thursday. Then Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, come watch as ropers spin the loops for the big money. Barrel racers turn the corners for the quick time, and bull riders try to ride some of the rankest bulls known to man. It all happens March 23rd through the 26th, and March is also Ford Truck Month at Sanderson Ford, and Sanderson Ford has trucks. Right now, get 2.9 APR financing for 66 months on new Edges, F-150 trucks, Escapes, Explorers, and Expeditions, plus $2,000 cash back on Edge, $1,000 on F-150 XLT trucks, and $500 on Escape, Explorer, and Expedition. Show up to Sanderson Ford Cave Creek Pro Rodeo just like I do in a new Sanderson Ford. This is Sanderson Ford Country. For tickets and more rodeo info, go to cavecreekrodeo.com.
John Bloom, Suns Post Game Show. Brought to you by Budweiser Zero.
As a Kogi goes strong and throws it down with a right hand, counted, and the foul on Malik Monk, so that'll wake everybody up. J.O. taking it to the rack.
You know, we might have to rename the Hustle Award the Josh Okogie Hustle Award. He seems to win it just about every other night. We're going to give it to him again tonight. Okogie, 15 points for the Suns starting on that front line again tonight. Knocked down three-pointers, three out of six from beyond the arc. Didn't have a huge night rebounding the basketball. But if Josh Okogie can knock down a three-point shot when he's got it open, he's going to help this team certainly down the stretch and in the postseason. He did that tonight, again, with 15 points, but just not enough from the rest of the Suns' supporting cast on this night to match the firepower of the high-scoring Kings. 128-119 again, the final tonight. The Kings get 19 from Harrison Barnes and 18 points from De'Aaron Fox. Fox, of course, an all-star and one of the best clutch players in the NBA. And sure enough, one of the bigger baskets of the game, just about a minute to play. The Kings up by only a single point. And De'Aaron Fox knocks down the jumper to put him up 121-118. And the Kings never looked back. So in honor of De'Aaron Fox, we bring you the song of the night.
Fox on the Run, courtesy of the band Sweet. Little old school kick and tunage tonight here on the Suns postgame report. That brings us to the NBA scoreboard. A lot of Suns had their eyes on the Grizzlies game tonight, taking on the Mavericks in Memphis, but the Mavs come in shorthanded. They bring a knife to a gunfight without not only Luka, but Kyrie Irving did not play, and the Grizzlies get the win 112-108, the final there. Big one tonight. In San Francisco, the Warriors in overtime take down the Bucks. Curry hit a three at the end of regulation to send it to OT. All Warriors in OT, they knock off the Bucks 125-116. Those will be the Suns' next two opponents. All right, around the NBA we go now. The Clippers knock off the Knicks 106-95, the final there. Jazz winner tonight in Charlotte 119-111, the final. Pistons fall to the Pacers in Detroit 121-115, the final.
final. Their magic winner over the Heat in overtime, 126-114. The Jason Tatum scores 34 as the Celtics knock off the Hawks, 134-125. Bulls over the Rockets in Houston, 119-111. That was that final. And one other one to tell you about, Oklahoma City tonight on the road in New Orleans. They take down the Pelicans, 110-96. Final score from Footprint Center in Phoenix, 128-119. Kings over the Suns. Suns now trail both the Kings and the Grizzlies by 3.5 games in the Western Conference. Off day tomorrow for the Suns. Next up, Monday night, Steph Curry and the Golden State Warriors in San Francisco. For Zach Larson and Lauren Koval behind the glass, I'm Tim Ring. Thanks for hanging tonight on the Suns post-game report. Once again, the final from downtown Phoenix. The Kings, 128. The Suns, 119. We'll see you again, everybody, on Monday night.
Arizona Sports, the local sports leader.
You've been listening to Phoenix Suns basketball.
We now join ESPN Radio, already in progress.
She wears them on her left ring finger, obviously. She didn't want to lose it down the drain. And so she takes them off, and then after she's done with the dishes, she puts her wedding band and her engagement ring back on her hand. Problem is, she puts it on the wrong finger. It's an issue because she can't get it off of her middle finger. At what point do I have the right to be outraged?
You think you have a reason to be upset about that?
Now, I'm not saying I have a reason, but I feel like I have a right.
The three most important words that you need to know are pick your spots. There is no reason for you to be upset.
But if I did it, she would have a problem with it, which is why I feel like I have a right to be upset.
Yes, rookie. Welcome to the NFL.
Canty and Carlin. Weekdays at 3 Eastern on ESPN Radio and on the ESPN app.
Keyshawn, J. Will, and Max.
Dan Orlovsky, ESPN football analyst.
I average $17 million a year as a receiver. Did I ever see $17 million a year as a receiver? No, no. So I don't care about that. What's the real money?
You average $17 million a year?
Never seen it. never seen a penny.
You ain't taking me to dinner or lunch once.
TJ and Max, followed by Greeny. Mornings on ESPN Radio and on the ESPN app. Progress is a long, hard-fought road. From Rupp's Runts to Dawn's Dynasty and everything in between. This is a conference of inclusion and evolution. After all, true legends don't just change the game. They pave the way. Southern Hoops, a history of SEC basketball. Part 7, Monday at 9 p.m. Eastern on SEC Network. Presented by Pfizer-BioNTech.
Hey, it's Greeny, and hope you're enjoying this week. And I can tell you all I'm doing is sitting and refreshing Twitter every 15 seconds, waiting for news on Aaron Rodgers coming to the Jets. We'll talk about that Selection Sunday and more Monday. It's Greeny, starting 10 a.m. Eastern on ESPN Radio and the ESPN app.
I'm Googling. I can find anything. Come on, dude. You know I love you. I gotta go.
I don't think I want to give that guy any advice on anything.
Paul Feinbaum, weekdays at 3 Eastern on the ESPN app and the SEC Network.
SportsCenter. I'm Dave Nager. It is Selection Sunday on the East Coast. Also, daylight savings. Sorry about that. Pac-12 championship. 7 minutes remaining. UCLA leading Arizona 54-50. It's on ESPN. John Shire winning his first shot at the ACC championship as head coach at Duke.
Cross-court pass. Proctor in the corner of three. Good! Tyrese Proctor with a triple to answer McNeely's at the other end.
My Cousins, ESPN Radio, that put Duke up by 9 in the second half. The final, Blue Devils 59, Virginia 49. Jeremy Roach scored 23. The Iona chapter of Rick Pitino's career revival is on to the NCAAs. In the Metro Atlantic, the Gales beat Marist 76-55. Conference USA, Florida Atlantic beat UAB 78-56. Texas Southern and Dayton are also in. Big 12 championship game, Texas took out top-seeded Kansas by 20, 76-56. NBA, Stephen Curry scored 9 in overtime, 36 on the game, as Golden State beat the Bucks 125-116. Jason Tatum with a double-double.
White working the ball to the left. Finds Tatum, who's alone for 3. He made it. Another big boy shot from Jason Tatum.
34 points, 15 rebounds. Jonathan Wallach on WBZ-FM. Celtics beat Atlanta 134-125. NHL third period scores. Seattle 3, Dallas 2. Vancouver 4, Ottawa nothing. Minnesota 2, St. Louis 1. Nashville and LA tied at 1.
Coming up Monday, before you submit your bracket into the ESPN Tournament Challenge, I'll tell you which teams you should avoid and who is primed for a big-time run. Keyshawn, J. Will, and Max, Monday morning at 6 a.m. Eastern on ESPN Radio, E2, and ESPNU.
They came out here and weren't scared of the moment.
By Sir Jabari Rice, who lays it in, and 1.
This has been a resilient group all year long. We're just so proud of these guys.
The Texas Longhorns are the Big 12 tournament champions.
There is an absolute slugfest going on right now in the Pac-12 championship, taking place in Las Vegas. UCLA is on top of Arizona right now, 54-52 with 5:50 left to go. This is an absolute fantastic game, Pac-12 championship. This is Game Night Championship Saturday special on ESPN Radio, the ESPN app, SiriusXM, Channel 80. We're presented by BrooklynIn.com with Drew Carter. I'm Q Myers, and as we continue to update you on this Pac-12 championship, we also want to take a look at conferences, at the conferences that are going to be dancing. Selection Sunday is going to go on later on this afternoon here on ESPN Radio, and we'll be able to see where all these teams are going. But Drew, we want to take a look at all the conferences and see how many teams are going to go and what conference you should really be focusing on that could hoist the whole thing and win that national championship.
Yeah, right now Joe Lenardi's got 9 teams from the Big Ten in the field of 68, 8 from the SEC, and 7 from Q's beloved Big 12.
Why you gotta throw me out there like that?
Look, man, I already talked about my Syracuse bias earlier on the show with Kesty, so I got to throw that out there. Look, Q covered the Big 12, and I think rightfully so, you view it as the best league in America.
Absolutely.
We're all on the same page on that. They're going to get 7 of their 10 teams in the big dance. They've won the tournament the last 2 years with Baylor and Kansas. The question, though, is if I gave you the Big 12 or the field to win the national championship, who you got?
I would probably go with the field, right? And the reason I choose the field, I would go with the field, and this is the reason why. I mean, I want to say the Big 12, right? Because like you said, that's the conference that I covered. That's the conference that I believe is the best conference in the country. The problem is they beat each other up so much all year long. They beat each other up in the conference tournament. And then when they get to the big dance, then all of a sudden they could have a bad game. And if you have a bad game, you don't get after it defensively, you have an off day shooting, all of a sudden you look up and that team that you probably feel like you should have beat you. And that's what tournament play is all about. So as much as I want to look at and say, as you mentioned, the last 2 champions have come out of the Big 12, that they're going to make it 3 in a row, I look at Kansas and I don't think they're as good as last year's championship team. Mm-hmm. I think they're good. I don't think they're as good. Texas is really good defensively. They can ratchet it up. Their shooting is streaky, though, right? I mean, so I can find warts with everybody. Let's put it like that. Baylor's down. They're not who they were. So there's other teams that are going to be represented from the Big 12 that are good, but I just think when it comes down to it in tournament style, they're probably going to take an L sooner than they expect.
Yeah, I feel like the strength of the league is the depth, so even if they don't end up winning another national championship for the 3rd year in a row, You look at the teams that are going to be in the tournament.
Right.
Like, you can go down the line, and even though we can pick nits with every one of them, Kansas, championship experience, won it all last year. Jalen Wilson, best player in the league, one of the best in the country. Great freshman, Grady Dick, great point guard, Dewan Harris. Like, they've got all the ingredients. And then you go down the line, and Texas can do the same thing. They can get to a Final Four. Baylor's got the best backcourt in the country. They can get to a Final Four. Kansas State's an amazing story. Jerome Tang,
He
could be a contender for National Coach of the Year. And I really think with their makeup, they are built like a Final Four team. An amazing point guard, Marquise Noel. Keontae Johnson, outstanding in the front court. He's an amazing story. Athleticism all over the place. They are tough as nails. K-State could be in the Final Four easily. Iowa State, not quite as sure, but They're one of the best defensive teams in America. They're right. Top 10 in KenPom on defense. TCU, man, the metrics don't even do them justice because Mike Miles missed some time. I think they were 1-5 without Mike Miles this year. He's back now. I kind of thought they were going to win the Big 12 tournament. They just ran into Texas in the semifinals.
They're not as consistent, you know, I'm with you on that, though. I thought that they were going to make a deeper run in the Big 12 tournament, and then they come up short, and I'm thinking, that's that little bug, that bugaboo that nags with them. You know, it's there.
But the ceiling is so high, and I feel like the inconsistency has really just come from injuries for the most part, missing Miles. Oklahoma State's probably not in, but West Virginia, they're dangerous. I mean, they're 17th in the country in KenPom overall, despite the fact that they were sub 500 in league play. I just feel like the strength of the league comes from the depth. So instead of asking the question like Big 12 versus the field to win it all, you probably put the over under on teams in the Sweet 16 at like 4.5. Because
I can see that. I can agree with that. Yeah.
You know, any of the seven who are going to make it could easily get to the second weekend.
I can see that for sure. I would definitely sign up for that. I just feel like it's kind of top heavy when it comes. And you're right. The depth is there. But I just feel like the depth is going to catch up to itself just because the inconsistencies that they've had. And even a team like Baylor, if Baylor was playing at a higher level, even though they do have that great backcourt, they were playing a little bit better than what they did this past year. And you saw they took an early exit in the Big 12 championship tournament, which I was surprised by that as well. Coach Drew does a fantastic job there. And you mentioned Coach Tang, man, that story that he's turned K-State into, that is fantastic. I don't know how this run ends for K-State, but man, it's been a fun ride all season long under Coach Tang.
Yeah, I mean, think about in the summer, Jerome Tang was in the building, his staff was in the building, Marquise Noel was there, Ish Massoud was there, and nobody else.
Right.
I think they had two players at one point in the offseason. Mm-hmm. You bring in a couple of freshmen, you bring in some transfers. I mean, Keontae Johnson might be an even better story than Jerome Tang. Like, for those who forgot, Keontae Johnson was SEC preseason player of the year at Florida, and then in a December game against Florida State, collapsed on the floor, and this was all the way back in December of 2020. Collapsed on the floor and didn't play until this year for Kansas State. And we weren't even sure if he was going to survive, let alone play college basketball again. And now he's one of the best players in the best league in the country. So Kansas State, the story they've authored is amazing. And I don't think it's just some feel-good story that, oh, it's great they got a top four seed in the NCAA tournament. I totally think they can make the Final Four. And you know, Q, they've beat up on each other all season long. Mm-hmm. They might even cannibalize each other once they get to the tournament.
Right.
Because they're going to have several teams on the top four seed lines. Mm-hmm. And I know the committee tries to avoid matching up conference teams really at any point in the tournament, but especially in the first weekend. And the Big 12, I mean, the committee's got to be looking up and saying, good thing there's only 10 teams in this league. Because if they had 15 teams in the league, they get 70% of the teams, and you're looking at 11 or 12 teams from the Big 12. And really, like, even Texas Tech, and I know they're dealing with some off-the-court issues right now, and Mark Adams has left the program. But Texas Tech, at one point, they won 5 games in a row, and Joe Lunardi was like, here we go. Like, Texas Tech has a chance to make the tournament. And Oklahoma State, they've got a chance to get in as well. So the league is ridiculous. I kind of share your concern that they have bullied each other so much this year. It's kind of what we see with the Big Ten every season.
Right.
Those games are so physical. Mm-hmm. They're grinded out. Once you get into the tournament, maybe the whistle's a little bit tighter. And those teams are playing, you know, teams from smaller conferences or even other power conferences. And the style just doesn't work quite as well. We've seen that with the Big Ten a couple times in the past few years. Maybe that happens to the Big 12 this season.
That's always was our concern when we were just covering the Big 12 and we were looking at the teams in general. We always thought that, you know, because they beat up on each other all year long, that come tournament time, it was going to be a struggle. And, you know, you look at Lenardi's bracket. He has Kansas as the 1 seed. He has Texas as a 2 seed. He has Baylor and K-State as a 3 seed. Right. So, I mean, they all have opportunities to make a nice little run. Right. If it plays out that way, obviously we'll find out on Selection Sunday. But I mean, man, those those teams, I just feel like that they, even if you go back and look at their seasons and the way that they played each other, man, they just battled and battled and battled till the end. And so now at this point, you know, and now they have to play another style, right? They're not going to always play against a team that they're used to. So now they're going to play with against someone who's completely foreign to them. So that's another battle that they have to face as well. So, but again, very talented conference, no doubt.
Yeah. And TCU and Iowa State are probably going to be five seeds. That's where Lenardi has them in his next four after those top four seed lines. So the Big 12 is the deepest conference and the best conference. But if I'm looking at leagues that are going to have the most success in the big dance, I kind of like the SEC. Like we talked about Alabama earlier on in the show. I feel like, you know, if I had to make a bet to win the national championship, I like them a lot. Best player, super efficient on both sides of the floor. I think Alabama's a great bet to win it all. Tennessee, you know, with Rick Barnes, I always hesitate to pencil them deep into my bracket because it feels like every year they underachieve.
Right.
But they're so good defensively. Tennessee, I mean, that's going to translate to the tournament. Texas A&M's the two seed in the SEC. They're playing Alabama in the conference championship tomorrow. And I'm actually in a group chat with some of my friends from home where these guys might be playing games of chance, if you know what I'm saying. They like to be invested in the outcomes.
Right.
And they say if it weren't for Texas A&M, they'd be in like crazy debt. They always bet on Texas A&M, and Texas A&M always delivers, especially down the stretch. They did the same thing last year when they almost got themselves in the tournament. And that was, you know, a lot of people think one of the great injustices of Selection Sunday last year that A&M didn't make it. Mm-hmm. They are delivering on that promise this year. You know, they're going to be a top eight seed, and no one wants to play them. Vanderbilt might get in the tournament. Did anyone expect that to be the case? Arkansas. No. Arkansas should get in, and they're super talented. They were top five team in the preseason. And then Mizzou, who, you know, went toe-to-toe with Alabama for 30 minutes today, the metrics love them as well. So I feel like the SEC's got a real chance to send a bunch of teams deep into this tournament.
Well, if that happens, then all of a sudden you're going to have the SEC pounding their chest in college football. Oh, and then they'll be pounding their chest when it comes to college hoops, too.
Just means
SEC,
more.
SEC. Uh-huh. That's all they need. That's all they need. That's just the fuel to the fire. He's Drew Carter. I'm Q Myers. Coming up, we're going to get you ready for Selection Sunday. This is the Game Night Championship Saturday special on ESPN Radio and the ESPN app.
Where does it look more likely that Kyrie lands? Dallas, Phoenix, the Lakers, or somewhere else?
Let's see how it goes in Dallas. If Dallas is willing to pay Kyrie Irving, my bet is that's where Kyrie Irving will be.
More from Keyshawn, Jay Will, and Max. Weekday mornings at 6 Eastern on ESPN Radio and on ESPN2.
Nobody cares what you did in your bracket. Nobody cares.
Listen to the College Game Day podcast with Reese Davis and Pete Thamel wherever you listen to podcasts.
The secret to crushing your ESPN tournament challenge bracket isn't statistics or analytics. It's your gut, your instincts, the answer in your abdomen, the fire in your belly, the feely feels in your tummy tum, the hunch brewing in your bread basket. This March, when your gut speaks, listen. Download the ESPN Tournament Challenge app to sign up. Presented by Acura, Allstate, and McDonald's.
Coming up Monday, as the NBA season heads into the final stretch, which teams have separated themselves from the pack? My answer might surprise you. Keyshawn, J. Will, and Max, Monday morning at 6 Eastern on ESPN Radio, E2, and ESPNU.
BXFL gets you closer to football than ever before, where every decision is crucial and anything could happen. Today, the Arlington Renegades take on the St. Louis Battlehawks at 4 p.m. Eastern on ESPN2. And the Vegas Vipers face the D.C. Defenders at 7 p.m. Catch every XFL game on ESPN+. Bring it in.
Did you miss Canty and Carlin?
Who would scare you more? We're going to play tough defense. We're going to rough you up a little bit. The Knicks or the Miami Heat?
Oh, the Knicks this season. When's the last time the Knicks beat the Celtics three times in the season?
I understand that. I also know it's the regular season. They smoked the Hawks in the regular season a couple of years ago, and then they got destroyed in the playoffs.
Well, you just said that this is a better team. It's not a fait accompli that the Knicks are going to be a first-round exit in the postseason.
Canty and Carlin, weekdays at 3 Eastern on ESPN Radio and on the ESPN app.
It's Lance Shelby, previously on the Paul Feinbaum Show.
Hey, Paul, you're just up the road about a couple hours. I should grab Kenny Payne and come down visit. He's got nothing to do now.
Yeah, by the way, I am close to Louisville. I've already been offered that job because anyone can win 4 games. That's still hard for me to believe.
The Paul Feinbaum Show, weekdays at 3 Eastern on the ESPN app and on the SEC Network.
Come to Chance League. March college basketball is here.
This is it. No more chances. Tomorrow's not guaranteed.
The moment that they've been waiting for.
I get goosebumps.
And anything is possible.
So take the three. Hydration. Buckle up. Oh.
That says it all right there.
Are you serious? Let the party begin.
Champ Week, presented by Principal, continues through March 12th on ESPN.
Conferences mean circle dates. Legendary careers at one place.
A star is born.
It's a neighborhood on hardwood, settling scores.
We gotta win this game if we do us.
Now the time has come for tickets to be punched and titles won. Welcome to Champ Week.
Arizona's Courtney Ramey hit a big three-pointer, put Arizona up 60-58 with 15 seconds left in the Pac-12 championship. What a game. Actually, there's 16.9 seconds left. It's game night on championship. It's game night, championship Saturday special here on ESPN Radio on the ESPN app, SiriusXM Channel 80, presented by BrookLinen.com with Drew Carter. I'm Q Myers. We're also presented by Progressive Insurance. Drivers who switch and save with Progressive save nearly $700 on average. Call or click today and find out if they can save you hundreds on your car insurance. And so, Drew, as this game is getting down to the wire, it's about to get wrapped up with just under 10 seconds left to go, 60-58. Excited about this one, but also want to preview some of the championship games that are going to take place tomorrow, including Penn State and Purdue. Penn State had a big win earlier today over Indiana.
This is an awesome, awesome matchup. Big Ten Tournament Championship, always the final game before the bracket reveal show. We talked with Joe Lenardi earlier on in the show. He says the committee is usually done with their work by the time this game happens. So it really won't have an effect on March Madness seeding, we don't think. By the way, Tiger Campbell just missed the second end of a 1-1. So UCLA's down by one. Arizona shooting free throws with 6 seconds left. So Arizona in the driver's seat in the Pac-12 tournament. But I'm more interested in the Big Ten championship because Penn State is a 10 seed.
Mm-hmm.
They have run through this thing. They knock off Indiana today, breaking up what would have been a dream matchup for whatever network this game's being broadcast on. If it's not ESPN, we don't care. But whatever network this game's being broadcast on was probably salivating at the idea of Indiana-Purdue,
right?
Which, you know, outside of Duke, Carolina, you could argue that's the best rivalry in college basketball. And there was a chance we saw it in the Big Ten championship. Penn State comes in there, busts it up. They really tried hard to blow it today against Indiana. Nittany Lions were up 15 with under 2 minutes to play. Indiana came all the way back, cut it to 1 at one point. But Penn State wins. They hang on. And now we get Micah Shrewsbury, Penn State young coach. His last stop was as a Matt Painter assistant at Purdue. So you get master versus protege. Purdue handled them in the regular season. But I'm just excited to see what Penn State can do. And if you haven't heard of Jalen Pickett, you got to watch this game. To me, he is one of the 5 best players in college basketball. He averages 17, 7, and 7. The only guy in the country who can say that. I like to call that the college basketball version of the LeBron. For the longest time, the LeBron was a 27-7-7. He averaged that every year in the NBA. Mm-hmm. College hoops, a little more low scoring, so 17-7-7. He is the only guy doing that in the country. Jalen Pickett and Penn State, it'll be fun to watch tomorrow.
It really will. You know, and again, Penn State picking up that victory over Indiana. You mentioned it, man. They tried everything they could to give that game away, but came away with the victory. So there's the Big Ten championship. Now, Drew, I want to turn our attention to the SEC championship. We talked a lot about Alabama so far throughout the course of the evening. They're going up against Texas A&M. Texas A&M continues to win money for your buddies. Alabama's got the best player in the country, in my opinion, for multiple reasons. He's the best player on the court and he's probably got the strongest mind and will off the court, being able to block out all the outside noise when it comes to Miller and everything going on outside of the court for Alabama. What do you think about this matchup in the SEC championship?
Well, it's a good one. A&M beat Alabama in the regular season finale, but that game was in College Station. So I think it'll be a little different playing this one in Nashville. I spent 2 years in Birmingham, Alabama, so I know a thing or two about how psycho in the most endearing way Alabama fans are about Crimson Tide athletics. It's not too far
Roll
away.
Tide.
That's right. I heard that quite a few times. It's like, it's amazing, dude. Like when you live in Alabama, you might as well have on your driver's license, whether you say Roll Tide or War Eagle. It's incredible.
Right.
Everyone loves sports down there. And that's part of the reason it's so fun to live down there, I think, mm-hmm. as a sports fan. But Alabama, you know, a lot of the fans are in Birmingham, obviously Tuscaloosa. It's about a 3-hour drive to Nashville. I think that place is going to be crimson tomorrow. Mm-hmm. It's not going to be maroon for Texas A&M. It's going to be just a couple hues lighter and it'll be crimson. And I like Alabama to win this game handily. And I know my buddies aren't going to like to hear that because they're probably all going to, you know, be backing Texas A&M financially. But Alabama, to me, like we've talked about all night, is the best team in the country. I think they prove it tomorrow by winning the SEC championship against Texas A&M. And if they do, Q, I feel like they're going to be the number one overall seed mm-hmm. because Kansas lost today. And no shame in losing to a great Texas team. But if Bama wins their conference tournament, I feel like they should be number one overall.
I agree 100%. And they are one hell of a team. And, of course, there's so much going on surrounding the Alabama program. But they are just a great team. We're just talking about strictly on the court. They are great. If they win that SEC championship over Texas A&M, they definitely deserve to be number one overall. Speaking of the championship games, how about the Pac-12 championship? Arizona won 61-59. Drew, UCLA had an opportunity to knock down a three-pointer to win the game at the buzzer. It just hit off the front iron. But, man, you want to talk about a slugfest. If this is anything like we're going to see in March Madness, in the big dance, man, sign me up all day, every day of the week and twice on Sunday, because that was a fun one to watch.
Well, listen, so earlier we did the exercise. If could you get the Big 12 or the field?
Right.
I honestly think that if you are handicapping which conference has the best chance to win a national championship, I think the Pac-12 might have the best because the depth is not there. I mean, mm-hmm. outside of UCLA and Arizona, I don't think anyone expects there's a Final Four threat from this league. I think they'll probably only get one other team in. But between UCLA and Arizona, I think they'll both be two seeds tomorrow in the selection show. And they're both extremely dangerous. I feel like it was easy to write off UCLA when Jalen Clark went down for the season with an Achilles injury. He was a Pac-12 Defensive Player of the Year. The way they just put together a run in Vegas and almost won a Pac-12 championship, uber impressive. I feel like that's one of the big lessons from championship week is that UCLA is going to be okay without Jalen Clark. And Arizona, obviously, to win a knock-em-out, drag-out fight like that with 120 combined points, super impressive for an offense-first team. Can't wait to see what those two do in the big dance.
No, it's going to be fun. It really will. And tonight's game was fantastic. Real quick, Houston and Memphis, American Athletic Conference Championship. Is it Houston? Are you feeling Houston on this one?
I actually like Memphis.
Okay. Okay. I had H-Town on that one.
I think UH will sit out Sasser no matter how severe the injury is. They don't need this. I mean, they're going to be a one seed regardless.
Right.
Memphis beat them twice last year. Now, Houston has their number this year, and Houston's a better team. I think Houston is as good as anybody in the country. I kind of think Memphis will take this one, especially if Sasser, the American Conference Player of the Year, doesn't play. Give me the Tigers. Memphis State.
He's got Memphis. I've got H-Town. He's Drew Carter. I'm Q Myers. Tune into the ESPN Radio Selection Sunday Special 5 Eastern on ESPN Radio, ESPN App, SiriusXM, Channel 80. This has been the Game Night Championship Saturday Special on ESPN Radio and the ESPN App, also on SiriusXM.
Let's go!
80. GJ and Max.
I've seen enough of Justin Fields in a short period of time to make me believe if they do the right things in free agency and in the draft, 2 years from now, the Bears will be a playoff team.
More from Keyshawn, Jable, and Max. Weekday mornings at 6 Eastern on ESPN Radio and on ESPN2.
If you have ever thought about remodeling your bathroom but were worried it would take too long or cost too much, then stop worrying. Right now, Jacuzzi Bath Remodel has designed a collection of high-quality custom products and perfected the one-day remodeling experience so you can enjoy your new bathroom faster than ever before. It's a worry-free bath remodel from the most trusted brand name in the business, Jacuzzi. A Jacuzzi bath system fits in your existing tub space. It's a no-mess installation with an amazing style selection, factory-certified installers, and a limited lifetime warranty. Call 800-717-4599. That's 800-717-4599 right now and get 50% off installation with no interest and no payments for 12 months. Replace that old bathtub today with a walk-in shower for a safer bathing experience. If you have lived in your home for over 15 years, it's time to remodel your bathroom. For a virtual or in-home appointment, call 800-717-4599. That's 800-717-4599. 800-717-4599.
The Baseball Tonight Podcast
dictates everything that a viewer is seeing in front of them. Pitcher, batter, how could you possibly not show the pitch clock?
The Baseball Tonight Podcast is on the ESPN app or wherever you listen to podcasts. The decisive battle.
So one of the biggest football matches in the world.
The reigning champs, Real Madrid, versus the league leaders, FC Barcelona.
One of the biggest rivalries.
A champion will rise.
Lewandowski.
This is everything. This is El Clasico.
Benzema.
FC Barcelona, Real Madrid. Sunday at 4 p.m. Eastern on ESPN Plus and ESPN Deportes.
Hey, it's Greeny, and hope you're enjoying this week. And I can tell you all I'm doing is sitting and refreshing Twitter every 15 seconds, waiting for news on Aaron Rodgers coming to the Jets. We'll talk about that Selection Sunday and more Monday. It's Greeny. Starting 10 a.m. Eastern on ESPN Radio and the ESPN app.
Movies and dreams that you never forget.
ABC Sunday. It's the Oscars, movie's biggest celebration.
It's a really exciting event.
With performances by Rihanna, David Byrne, Sophia Carson, Lenny Kravitz, and more. Featuring awards for the best films, artists, and dream makers of the year.
And the Oscar goes to...
The Oscar goes to...
And the Oscar goes to...
Jimmy Kimmel hosts the Oscars, live Sunday on ABC. Yo, check this out from Canty and Carlin.
The only thing I have ever been afraid of, Brussels sprouts. I don't know why.
Why are you afraid of Brussels?
I don't know. I told you my mother was an absolute butcher in the kitchen.
Okay.
Just terrible.
I can't tell by your stature.
Well, I know. Well, I went elsewhere to fulfill my needs. They had like these little pointy things to them that just kind of freaked me out.
Are you sure they were Brussels sprouts?
I think they were.
Canty and Carlin, weekdays at 3 Eastern on ESPN Radio and on the ESPN app.
This is Jerome from Birmingham, previously from the Paul Feinbaum Show.
Mark is up next in Tuscaloosa. Hey, Mark.
So you remember Country Boy Eddie used to do a little something like this here at Paul?
Yeah, no, I remember Eddie well.
Well, hey, you know, you're right there in Nashville and country music.
Give it a shot.
That
was memorable.
The Paul Feinbaum Show, weekdays at 3 Eastern on the ESPN app and on the SEC Network.
Come to Champ Week. March College Basketball is here.
This is it. No more chances. Tomorrow's not guaranteed.
The moment that they've been waiting for.
I get goosebumps.
And anything is possible.
So take the three. Patriots. Buckle up.
That says it all right there.
Are you serious? Let the party begin.
Champ Week, presented by Principal, continues through March 12th on ESPN.
We'll be right back. center all night.
Teams continue to punch their ticket into the big dance.
Hawkins looking, throws to Odom. Odom, the kick, Dockery free, connect.
The Bucks and Warriors headline the association tonight.
Draymond Green bounce pass backwards to Curry. Curry stops and pops, contested three. That's a swish. Carter played that well, but Curry just said, nope, I got this.
Plus, all the action around the NBA.
George has head up, leave it court. Same spot for three, kaboom! Eric Gordon!
And will Lamar Jackson remain a Raven?
Eric's been banging his head, you know, proposing a lot of different things, you know, short-term deals, long-term deals, short-term guarantee deals, you know, all these different things. And I just think, you know, that Lamar is stubborn.
This is SportsCenter All Night.
It's happening! It has happened! The horn sounds!
SportsCenter All Night, ESPN Radio, and the ESPN app, Sirius XM Channel 80. I'm Alex Sobariu here with you, ESPN Radio, presented by Progressive Insurance. We've got a lot to get to today, including some NFL news regarding some quarterbacks, a new one in New Orleans introduced. But for college basketball fans and for casuals who just like to fill out a bracket, the magical day has arrived. It is Selection Sunday, and later today we will know the 68 teams in the men's tournament field. 13 automatic bids were handed out today, and we'll start with the showdown in Greensboro in the ACC tournament title game, a game you watched on ESPN and you heard here on ESPN Radio. Virginia and Red Hot Duke. Virginia got to the title game with an impressive 20-point win over Clemson, while Duke took care of 14th-ranked Miami behind a double-double from Kyle Filipowski. Duke looking for their 22nd ACC title. They're riding an 8-game win streak. Their last loss, an overtime loss, to Virginia back in early February. Cavaliers looking for their 4th ACC tournament title. Struggles abound offensively for Virginia. They scored just 17 first-half points. Duke got it to double digits in the first half, but the Cavs would get it to 7 at halftime at 24-17. Then in the second half, Jeremy Roach pushed the lead to 14.
In the left side corner, Roach has time, puts up a three, and it's good. Jeremy Roach, he's got a dozen. The second Blue Devil, over 10 points, along with Kyle Filipowski, a game-high 13. Duke now up by a game-high 14 points, 36-22.
Mike Cousins on the call here on ESPN Radio, and Kyle Filipowski turns defense to offense to get the lead back to 11.
Step back triple, Armand Franklin, way too much on it. Backboard only. Dunn underneath, gets the rebound. Sends it out for McNeely, left side, outside the arc. Into the paint, Franklin tipped away. Filipowski, running the floor, right to left, and jams with two. Duke by 11, 43-32, and Tony Bennett has no choice but to call a Virginia timeout with 7:30 to go.
Duke able to keep Virginia at arm's length, but after an Isaac McNeely three with 3 minutes to go, Virginia was back within six. Next possession, though, Jeremy Roach draws contact.
Roach at the right angle, drives right side of the lane against Clark. Layup is good, foul as well, and Duke feeling it here with 2:38 to go and a 51-43 lead over Virginia.
A free throw would be good to make it 52-43. And down the stretch, Duke would make their free throws in the foul game as they finish off Virginia with a 59-49 victory. John Shire becomes the first person to win the ACC tournament as a player and as a head coach, taking them there in his first season after taking over the job from Mike Krzyzewski in the offseason. Duke on a 9-game win streak. Let's hear from the guys that called this one on ESPN Radio, Mike Cousins and Malcolm Huckabee, for our postgame extra.
Greensboro, North Carolina, a raucous scene, blue and white confetti raining down from the sky as the clock hits zero on a 59-49 win for the Duke Blue Devils over the Virginia Cavaliers in the title game of the ACC tournament. Duke made its run against Pittsburgh, against Miami, which was the number one seed, and here taking out the number two seed, co-regular season champion Virginia, and they did it in dominant fashion in this title game, not trailing for a single second.
Well, I think it started off of their dominance in the paint. The paint points, I think that was the difference in this one. Duke, 24 points in the paint, and then the turnovers. Duke did a great job creating some offense with the turnovers. 13 points off of turnovers in this game, but I have to go back to the two key players. Kyle Filipowski, he is a matchup nightmare. Would not be surprised to see him be a lottery pick. He is a handful of guards. Seven-footer, can shoot threes, can handle. He is a guy that is almost impossible to guard one-on-one. But I'm going to go back to Jeremy Roach. I think the most important player on the Duke team. 23 points, 7 of 12 from the floor, and when it was winning time, the ball was in his hand. Perfect 7 of 7 from the free throw line. Duke is a dangerous team. Mike, I would not be surprised to see them go very deep in the NCAA tournament.
They go into the postseason on a 9-game winning streak. They had lost back-to-back games against Miami and another opponent in the ACC who's escaping my mind right now. But after the Miami loss, they called a players-only meeting, and that really turned the tide on their season. Kyle Filipowski, a phenomenal run here in three games, scored 59 points. Jeremy Roach with 23. And after Duke held Virginia to its lowest scoring first half of the year, they only had to outscore them by three in the second, and they win it 59-49 in the ACC championship game. For Malcolm Huckabee, I'm Mike Cousins. Right here on your home court for college basketball, ESPN Radio. Now let's go back to the studio.
All right, thanks, Mike. Jeremy Roach again led the way for Duke with 23 points. Filipowski with 20 points and 10 rebounds. Again, it's the 45th NCAA tournament appearance for Duke, the fifth among active Division I programs, and the 22nd ACC tournament championship, most in conference history. North Carolina is second with 18. Meanwhile, in Kansas City, the Big 12 tournament finals featured the top two seeds, and for the first time, the two Division I leaders in Quad 1 victories meeting for a conference championship. Third-ranked Kansas taking on seventh-ranked Texas. The Longhorns with a six-point win against TCU on Friday. Kansas with an impressive runaway victory over Iowa State. The Horns and Jayhawks split the season series, but Texas rounded out the regular season with a 16-point home victory against the Jayhawks. Jalen Wilson has a team-high 25 points in the semifinal win, and with the Jayhawks down by three, he helped pull them even in the first half.
Wilson, the conference player of the year at the top, 20 points a game average. At 25 and 10 yesterday. He's on the left. Uday sets the screen. Now a three-pointer up by Wilson. All net for Jalen Wilson. He got 10.
Yeah, he's comfortable. The thing about Jalen Wilson is you have to make him uncomfortable to get up in him and pressure him.
Tied the game at 19 at that point. Later in the half, Wilson put the Jayhawks in front.
6:20 left in our first half. High screen for Mude. Wilson drives through it, fires to Pettiford on the right, back to Wilson, corner right. They clear out the right side. He rises, he fires, and he nails it with his foot on the line. That'll be a deep two for Jalen Wilson, who's got 14 points.
Made it a 28-25 game that was here on ESPN Radio, but Texas responded. Marcus Carr, who struggled with his shot in the tournament. He was just 5 for 25 combined in the quarterfinals and semis, but did get a bucket to increase the Texas lead just before halftime.
Cunningham on the arc against Wilson. Flips it to Carr. 3 seconds to shoot. Carr drives. Carr puts it off the window, and it goes home at the end of the first half. Texas throws up 39 in the first half, and they'll take a six-point lead to the locker room.
That six-point lead, 39-33. Moving on to the second half, Texas kept pouring it on. Marcus Carr added to his total, putting the Texas Longhorns up by double digits.
Bishop, the Kansas City native, drives, kicks out to a wide-open Marcus Carr, and he buries a three. Three big hits for Carr here in the second half.
Texas hasn't shot the three well, but they're still good basketball players. Way too good to be left alone like that.
Okay, Mark Kestisher on the call here on ESPN Radio. Horns continue to build separation up by 10. Sir Jabari Rice increased the Horns' lead.
Carr gets by him, into the lane, looks to pass to the wing. It bounces, it's picked up by Rice, misses the three. Offensive board to Sue, shot no good. Another offensive rebound, Cunningham no good. He gets a third offensive rebound. Finds Sir Jabari Rice, who lays it in, and one.
Then Artario Morris throws one down to put this one on ice for the Longhorns.
Wilson with 24 behind the Adams screen. Darts against Dessou. Out to Yesufu. Joseph drives in the lane. Stripped by Cunningham. Steal Texas. Now they got a 3-on-1. Rice floats for the rim. Oh, what a grab by Arterio Morris with a right hand. Jams it home. He scraped the ceiling to grab that one. And Texas goes up 20. It's a beatdown in Kansas City. Joseph Yesufu will drive high off the window, miss the shot, rebound, grabbed, and it's Texas coming away with it, and they could dribble out the final 8 seconds. A burnt orange Saturday night in Kansas City. The Texas Longhorns, for the second time in 3 years, are the Big 12 tournament champions, and they take down Kansas.
76-56, the final. It's the largest margin of defeat for Kansas in the Big 12 tournament ever. It's the Longhorns' 10th win over a ranked opponent this season, the most in Division I. Dylan Dessou led the way with 18 points. Rodney Terry taking over midseason after the dismissal of former head coach Chris Beard, now is the interim coach. Terry has a Big 12 tournament title. Here is the Texas coach with our Chris Button.
Coach, let's start on today. This is the second time in the last 8 days that you have beaten Kansas pretty handily. What was the difference today?
They're a really, really good team. I mean, well coached. You know, Wilson got off to a great start. We need to do a good job with him. I think just doing a good job on the supporting cast is what we had to do in this game.
That supporting cast, you've done it all week without one of your best players in Timmy Allen, and other guys stepped up. What are you most proud of in this team?
This has been a resilient group all year long. I'm just so proud of these guys. I'm just so happy for them. They worked their tails off, and the Big 12 champs.
Yes, they indeed they are. Texas Longhorns, the Big 12 tournament champions for 2023. Jalen Wilson, another impressive outing, though, for Kansas in the loss, 24 points. He had 71 total points in the tournament, second most all time for a KU player. Joe Lenardi has Kansas as the top overall seed entering play on Saturday. Texas projected to be a 2 seed. Now let's go around college basketball, see who else punched their ticket to the big dance. We'll go to the Big East at Madison Square Garden. Marquette taking on Xavier, the top 2 seeds. Marquette in control throughout thanks to Tyler Kolick. Marquette led by 15 at the half. In the second half, Kolick put this one on ice for 2 of his 20.
Mitchell has it still 25 feet away. Kolick will attack. Kolick in the lane. 6-footer good. Tyler Kolick with the hoop. Marquette's lead is 15. Marquette will dribble it out. Walson will do so. It's over. Impressive, dominant. Win the regular season by 2 games. Win the conference postseason tournament. Marquette champions in the Big East this year of everything. The final, Marquette 65, Xavier 50.
It's the first tournament title ever for Marquette in the Big East, clinching a 35th NCAA tournament appearance. It's only the second ever conference tournament title ever. They did win Conference USA earlier in their history. Tyler Kolick finished with 20 and was named the tournament's most outstanding player. For Shaka Smart, he's now led 3 different programs to conference tournament titles, but ever since his remarkable run with VCU, he's lost 7 straight NCAA tournament games.
Inbound to Parrish, and that's it. 2-1, and the Aztecs win. The Aztecs are your Mountain West Conference champions. Heck of a fight tonight for Utah State. A dejected Aggie team walks off the court, but they have nothing to hold their head down about. What a night tonight. Utah State fought like crazy. Nothing left in the tank, but they did everything they could, and they gave the Aztecs everything they wanted. But in the end, it's Aztecs 62, Utah State 57.
That was the Aztec Sports Network with the calls. We move from the Big East to the Mountain West. The top 2 seeds in that league squared off. 2 contrasting styles. The Aztecs win their 7th Mountain West tournament title as their defense held Utah State sharpshooters just 17% shooting from 3. San Diego State wins at 62-57. For the Aggies, Joe Lenardi has them in the field, though, as one of the last 4 byes with an 88% chance of getting into the field for the Aztecs, their 3rd tournament title in 6 seasons under Brian Dutcher. To the Midwest for the MAC tournament title game in Cleveland. Toledo, winners of 17 in a row, taking on a very good and veteran Kent State team. Kent State wins the MAC title 93-78 over Toledo. So the Flashes win the MAC. They're headed to the NCAA tournament for the 7th time in school history and their first since 2017. For Toledo, their NCAA tournament drought will continue. It's now at 42 years. Their last, 43 years. It's now been since 1980, the last time Toledo has made the NCAA tournament. Still more to come here on SportsCenter All Night on ESPN Radio. More teams making it into the big dance, but some NFL news to get to, including some follow-up from yesterday. The big trade that sent the number one overall pick to the Carolina Panthers. We'll hear from Mel Kiper next. This is SportsCenter All Night on ESPN Radio and the ESPN app.
Coming up Monday with the NFL free agency about to kick off, I'll tell you which free agent can turn your team into a Super Bowl contender. Keyshawn, J. Will, and Max, Monday morning at 6 Eastern on ESPN Radio, ESPN2, ESPNU.
This is SportsCenter All Night.
Tens of thousands affected by the toxic water at Camp Lejeune are left with death, cancer, Parkinson's, dementia, birth defects, and other serious illnesses. And along with the harm, so many worries.
My family drank the Camp Lejeune water. What if our health gets worse and we need more financial help?
How do I protect my VA benefits and get the compensation I deserve and need?
The answer is simple. Call James Harris Law, the experienced, trusted law firm that can get you significant compensation while protecting all your VA benefits. We're already fighting for hundreds of Marines, families, and civilians who drank Camp Lejeune water. But if you miss the deadline, you could forever lose your right to the justice you deserve. So call our Camp Lejeune legal helpline now. Now may be your last chance to receive full compensation. Don't delay. Call 800-350-3322. That's 800-350-3322. 800-350-3322.
We're covering spring training in the Cactus League, presented by R&K Building Supplies and Michelob Ultra, the home of Arizona Diamondbacks baseball.
Arizona Sports, the local sports leader.
Switched to Boost Mobile and got a free Samsung Galaxy A23 5G phone. Want to know the best part?
It was free?
Nope.
The fact that it's on America's largest 5G networks?
Nope. It's the ding.
Oh, yeah. Love the ding.
Right? It's all about the ding. It's the dingarooski, the dingarona, the ring-a-ding-ding.
Unleash your power to save with Boost. Get a free Samsung Galaxy A23 5G phone when you switch. Boost Mobile. Unleash your power.
And the ding.
Limited time offer. New customers only. Available on select networks. 5G not available everywhere. One device per line. Tax excluded. Additional restrictions apply. See your local Boost Mobile store for details.
Yeah, I'm so stressed. Our business is growing. We've got people all over now.
Ooma.
What is that? Meditation?
I'm recommending the Ooma cloud phone system with auto attendant and more than 50 features.
Ooma?
Yep. Switching to Ooma is a cinch. Just $24.95 per month per user, plus taxes and fees.
Ooma.
Now you're feeling it. Find Small Business Calm at ooma.com/radio. That's ooma.com/radio.
Breaking news.
Tax refund shock is everywhere, but what is it?
My tax refund shrank.
Mine too. The culprit? Pandemic-related stimulus payments and tax credits expiring. In this reporter's opinion, you need a tax expert.
Hey guys, Jackson Hewitt guarantees your biggest refund.
And tax prep is 50% off? Going there now.
50% off is a limited time offer for new clients filing at participating locations. Max value $200. Visit jacksonhewitt.com/50 for terms.
For adults with moderate to severe plaque psoriasis or candidates for systemic or phototherapy, now there's Skyrizi, risankizumab riza, a prescription-only 150-milligram injection. With Skyrizi, 3 out of 4 people achieve 90% clear skin at 4 months, and Skyrizi is just 4 doses a year after 2 starter doses.
Nothing in me go hand in hand. Nothing on my skin, that's my new place. Nothing is
Don't use if allergic to Skyrizi. Serious allergic reactions and an increased risk of infections or a lower ability to fight them may occur. Before treatment, your doctor should check for infection and tuberculosis. Tell your doctor if you have an infection or symptoms, such as fever, sweats, chills, muscle aches, or cough, or if you plan to or recently received a vaccine.
With Skyrizi, you could achieve 90% clearer skin. Ask your doctor about the number one dermatologist prescribed biologic in psoriasis and visit skyrizi.com or call 1-866-SKYRIZI to learn more.
Nights together are not better than what the Suns are putting on the floor on their best nights. It's very simple to me.
Fitz and Harry, weekdays at noon Eastern on ESPN Radio and on the ESPN app.
This is SportsCenter All Night on ESPN Radio and on the ESPN app.
SportsCenter All Night, ESPN Radio, and the ESPN app, SiriusXM Channel 80. ESPN Radio is presented by Progressive Insurance. Progressive Commercial Insurance flexes to fit your business's needs, from quick repairs to adjustable coverages and even payment options. Progressive Commercial makes it easy to get what you need. Quote today in as little as 6 minutes at progressivecommercial.com.
Breaking news, the Panthers have decided to move up to take the number one spot from the Bears.
The Bears were in position to make this deal, and they had multiple suitors for the number one overall pick.
Oh, this is a slam dunk for the Chicago Bears. You're talking about, you know, the fact that they got Justin Fields, and now he has true number one in DJ Moore.
The teardown was the right move, and now this is a quality move by a second-year general manager, beyond a quality move.
So you heard it there. We are a day removed from the massive trade by the Chicago Bears and Carolina Panthers, which sent the number one overall pick to the Panthers in exchange for four draft picks and wide receiver DJ Moore. Now, there's an opportunity to examine the fallout from this trade. Mel Kiper and Darian Mel on Saturday went over the trade compensation that the Bears received.
When you look at what he's done through his career after being the, you know, first round pick, 24th overall in 2018, he's going to only be 26 in April, so still young. 5 years in the league, he averaged 18-1 a catch in 2020, had 93 receptions in 2021, and 7 touchdown receptions this past year. So 364 career receptions, 14-3 average, and 21 touchdowns. He's not a one necessarily, but he's a two plus. Okay, so now you got him as a one and a, you know, one minus maybe. Okay, not a true number one receiver. And then you got Mooney the speedster. You got Claypool who's trying to figure it out in the NFL. But DJ Moore, you know, heck of an addition. And all the picks, as you mentioned, Gabe, they have 8 picks in the first 5 rounds. That's 8 of the top 149 players in this draft coming up in late April the Bears will have.
So you heard from Mel Kiper there on the Bears trade compensation, specifically talking about wide receiver DJ Moore. Meanwhile, Jeremy Fowler, who was also on Darian Mel today, analyzes whether the price was too steep for the Panthers to pay for the top pick.
No, not really. That's about what you would need. Because, you know, I was hearing even like teams in the top 7 trying to get up to one would need 2 ones and 2 twos. That's 2 first-round, 2 second-round picks. So basically Carolina did that plus DJ Moore. So the DJ Moore component offsets the 2 spots from 7 to 9, essentially, to get it done. So, you know, Carolina, that was a hard move to deal DJ Moore in the deal because he's a key receiver. But they also get the cap hit off their books, too, and can sort of get, you know, draft somebody else or start fresh there for the new quarterback. So let them build together as young players. So, you know, it all works out. I would say it's probably about right for that kind of jump.
So for the Panthers, you don't give up that many assets unless you have a good idea of who you're taking at the number one overall pick. The Panthers likely looking for their franchise quarterback. Could it be C.J. Stroud, perhaps Bryce Young? Once again, here's Jeremy Fowler and who the Panthers could be targeting at number one.
Well, I'm sure in their heart of hearts, they probably know. But as far as what they're portraying or what people are saying behind the scenes, no. I think with 47 days before the draft, I understand that they have up to 3 quarterbacks in mind. It's, of course, Bryce Young and T.J. Stroud, and then one wild card. That could be Will Levis or Anthony Richardson. You know, they really have no rush now. They just want to get in position to be able to do what they want. And they could back out into another spot. You know, like let's say fall in love with, I don't know, Will Levis, right? Then you know you can get him at 3 most likely. You could move back 2 spots. So there's stuff you could do to maneuver. And, you know, I think they wanted that flexibility.
Now is just the start of the wheeling and dealing before next month's NFL draft. Rumors have floated that the Texans may be interested in a deal with Carolina to move up to 1 from their 2. Cardinals have also been linked to dealing the number 3 overall pick. Matt Miller, ESPN NFL draft analyst, was also on Darian Mel on Saturday. Will we see any more pre-draft trades?
I do. I think we see a domino fall probably somewhat quickly.